The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Primitive man cowered and trembled before mysterious and malignant forces that dramatized his insignificance and vulnerability. And so, for thousands of years, mankind fought to establish the dignity and worth of the individual. And now, just when it seems that progress has been made, the individual is suddenly being threatened with even more vulnerability and insignificance. What's going on here, anyhow?
Who are you? How did you get in here?
Sir, my name is James Wilson, and I worked here for 20 years. And last week, you fired me.
Why would I fire you? I don't even know you.
Well, the fact is, I'm out. Why?
Because you did something wrong.
What?
Well, how do I know?
Well, how can I have done something wrong if no one knows what it is?
Now, look here. You did something wrong because if you didn't, you wouldn't have been fired, and that's all there is to it.
Mystery drama, The Solid Gold Zarf, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Sam Dan and stars Larry Haynes and Francis Sternhagen.
Radio Mystery Theater is brought to you in part by Pinnacle Books and will continue in a moment.
Are cogs in machines, and James Madison Wilson is a small cog in a huge machine known as Transcontinental. Transcontinental what, you may ask? To which I can only reply, Transcontinental everything. Transcontinental is one of those diversified corporations, one of those conglomerates. They make everything from alligator bags to Zarfs. And how do they keep track of everything? Simple. They use computers. Oh, you're probably saying they're in trouble already. But they also require battalions of auditors to keep all the balls in the air. And our James Madison Wilson occupies a desk in the middle of a huge office where he constantly analyzes and enters a never-ending stream of figures. Wilson?
Would you like to come in here for a minute, Jim?
Oh, sure, Bart, right away.
Sit down. Sit down, Jim.
What's up, Bart?
Look, Jim, I don't really know how to tell you this.
Tell me what?
You're fired.
What did you say?
That's the only way I could say it was to say it.
I'm fired?
Yeah, the notice just came down. Here, read it.
James Madison Wilson, Department A14-270K, is hereby terminated. Effective immediately. Subject to existing severance procedures.
But it's from upstairs.
Well, why?
I don't know, Jim.
Well, there has to be a reason.
Well, yes, I guess there is.
Well, what is it?
But I don't know.
Well, I can't be fired just like that out of a clear blue sky. Is there something wrong with my work?
No, not that I know of.
Well, I don't understand.
I'm sorry, Jim.
Oh, I have to know why. Could you find out why for me?
Well,
please, Bart.
All right, Jim. I'll try.
You're better off out of there.
Oh, Trudy, how can you say that?
Any company that can fire you just like that isn't worth working for.
Do you realize I'm out of a job?
It isn't the end of the world.
We just bought the house, the kids' teeth. Do you want me to go down the list?
I know the list. I pay the bills.
Do you realize I'm out of work?
Only until you find another job.
And where am I going to find another job?
You won't know until you look.
Why, Trudy, why am I out? What did I do wrong?
What's the difference?
I have to know. I have the right to know.
That was some game last night, Jim. Did you watch it on the TV?
No.
Like I always said, all they needed was another good right-handed pitcher.
Bart, did you talk to Mr. Dennison?
Jim,
Bart, you're my boss, and you say you don't know why I was fired.
Believe me, Jim, I don't.
So I'm just asking you to see your boss, George Dennison.
I did.
What did he say?
Nothing.
Well, he had to say something.
He doesn't know either.
But did you ask him if he could find out?
Jim.
No, you didn't. You didn't ask him, did you? Why not?
Well, he doesn't like it when people come in and bother him.
Well, now, Bart, you know how important this is to me. I thought we were friends.
But we are, Jim. We're good friends.
No, not anymore. Sorry you feel that way. Well, maybe it's not your fault, but I guess it's just the way things work out, like it was back in Vietnam. You had a good buddy, and when he got killed, that was the end of it. You can't be friends with the dead, right? As far as you're concerned, that's what I am, a casualty.
Oh, what kind of talk is this, Jim?
It's straight talk. You weren't willing to go out on a limb for me, Bart.
Look, I tried to explain the situation.
Yes, you did. And besides, from where you're sitting, I must have done something wrong.
Oh, Jim, I am not saying it was your fault.
Exactly. Thank you. But maybe it's not good politics to be known as a friend of mine at this time.
Jim, fact is, you did get fired. So you must have done something wrong. Now, why don't we just forget it, huh?
And why don't we also forget about having lunch together, too?
Who are you?
I'm Wilson. James Wilson, sir.
How did you get in here?
Well, I waited for your secretary to step out of her office.
What do you want?
My name is James Wilson. Does that mean anything to you?
Why should it?
Well, I worked here for 20 years.
So do 6,000 other people.
Well, I was fired last week.
What does that have to do with me?
Well, Mr. Dennison, you fired me.
Why would I fire you? I don't even know you.
Well, the fact is, I'm out, sir.
Well, maybe I did fire you. Is my secretary back yet? That woman's never around when she's wanted. Why don't I fire her? Miss Ruby, you are there. Good. Go through your memos or whatever and tell me why I fired a man named... what's your name again?
James Wilson.
James Wilson. What's that? You sure? All right. Well, that's that. She has no record of my ever having fired you.
Well, then why was I fired?
Well, who says you were fired?
Well, this letter, sir.
Oh, let me see that. Yes. Well, this is something else. It comes from upstairs.
Well, why would they fire me?
Obviously, you must have violated some company policy.
Well, I don't know of any company policy. I might have violated...
It doesn't matter. Ignorance is never an excuse.
Well, I'm sure I didn't. I couldn't have.
If you hadn't violated some company policy, you wouldn't have been fired. The fact that you were dismissed proves that you did. And that's all there is to it.
Oh, all right. Mr. Dennison, I can accept that. But I'm being fired after 20 years, and I don't know why. Now, do you suppose you could ask your boss?
Oh, yes, I could if I were a fool.
Well, why would you be a fool?
Well, A, it wouldn't change anything, so it'd be a waste of time. B, it would appear that I'm questioning, even challenging, company policy, which I have absolutely no intention of doing. The fact is, you were fired. Therefore, it was for a good reason. And let that be the end of the thing.
Are you the messenger from Transcontinental?
Yes, ma'am.
Come in.
Thank you. Is Mr. Anchors in?
Mr. Anchors?
Yes, Mr. Leslie Anchors.
I'm Leslie Anchors.
Oh.
You find it hard to accept a woman in my position, do you?
No, sir. I'm Adam.
What report am I supposed to give you for the office?
None.
None? Well, then what...
Please, listen. My name is James Wilson. I was in Department A14, 270K. And I worked there for 20 years. Suddenly, I was fired. And nobody can tell me why. My boss, Bart Scoville, couldn't. His boss, Mr. Dennison, couldn't. And according to the corporation charts, his boss is Leslie Anchors, and that's you. And I couldn't see you at the office. They wouldn't let me. The doorman and the security guard in your apartment house here. I had to feed them some kind of a story. Please. Please tell me. Read this memo. Tell me why. Was I fired? Nobody seems to know.
Well, I don't know either. And now, if you will be good enough
please,
to...
Please, don't be like the others.
Personnel is not my department.
Don't say that. Now, that's what's wrong with the world. That's how we justify letting bad things happen. But every department must be our department.
What is there you want me to do?
Yeah, I know. I knew that you would be different.
Why?
Because you're a woman.
Indeed.
Only a woman can understand what I'm going through now. I'm a man, the hunter, the provider, you see.
Oh, that's how you see yourself, is it?
Well, isn't that man's traditional role?
Continue.
I'm out of work. That means I can no longer fulfill a man's function.
Really?
I knew that you would see it. You're a mature woman. You're soft and gentle and understanding, and you're aware of a man's needs.
Get out.
But please...
Get out before I call the doorman and have you thrown out, you male chauvinist pig. All right. What's wrong?
You have to ask, Gertie. I'm out of work. For the first time in my adult life, I'm out of work.
There has to be a first time for everything.
Look, I was graduated from college. I joined Transcontinental. Then I went into the service. I came back. It's been almost 20 years.
Too long, if you ask me.
Trudy, I'm unemployed. I never thought that could happen to me.
Did you look for a job today?
Well, I had lunch. I mean, I started to have lunch with Bart.
What for?
Well, he promised he'd find out why I was fired.
Did he?
No.
Couldn't he ask?
No.
Why not?
Trudy, I don't want to go through it again. Bart doesn't know. His boss doesn't know. His boss's boss doesn't know.
The upshot is you don't know who fired you, and you don't know why. There's such a thing as a blessing in disguise. Be glad you're out of that madhouse, that snake pit.
Now, don't say that. Don't you dare.
Jim, let go of my arm.
Don't you ever say a thing like that again.
Jim, you're hurting me.
I'm sorry, Trudy. I'm sorry.
Whatever got into you?
Well, I just lost control, I guess, but I can't let anybody talk that way about my company.
Your company?
Yes, my company. I gave them 20 years of my life.
And what did they ever give you?
Well, they sustained me. They paid me a salary.
Oh, yes, a fantastic salary.
We lived on it. They gave me a health plan, a pension plan, various employee benefits.
Jim, are you serious?
And they gave me security.
Security? It was all an illusion.
Oh, no, no, Trudy. Somebody made a mistake.
Yes, and that somebody was you. All these years you were taken in by all that nonsense.
Now, don't you say that again.
All right, Jim, all right. I won't.
I love that company. That desk in that office, that was where I spent the best years of my life.
All right. I won't say another word.
And I wasn't just going through the motions either, Trudy. I knew what I was doing.
Sure?
To me, they weren't just a parade of dull and lifeless numbers. Each one meant something to me. Each signified a product. I could see the machine, the production line operator who made it. I could see it in the store and the person who bought it.
Your dinner's getting cold.
And I did things with those numbers, too, Trudy. I learned ways to keep them more accurately and feed them into the computers more efficiently. I didn't ask for any credit. I did it because it was the right thing to do.
Did you want any soup?
It's my job. It belongs to me. And I'm going to get it back. If it's the very last thing I ever do.
And it may very well be. You can see the problem. It appears simple at first, but then the complexities multiply. Doesn't this man know when he's licked? Maybe we'd better not sell him short. After all, it was the people who didn't know when they were licked who changed the world, especially in Act Two. A place for everything, and everything in its place. That's the way things are with most of us, more or less. We have our place, our job, and the role we play. But then sometimes we fall out of place. We lose our job, and our role changes. And so does the whole world.
Jim, you have to go out and get a job.
A job?
Yes, a job. We don't have enough left in the bank to cover next month's mortgage.
Trudy, I wish...
I know what you wish. You wish you knew why you were fired. You wish you could get your old job back again. But you can't. It's over, and that's all there is to it. I don't want to hear one more word about it. The first thing in the morning, you're going out to look for a job.
I just can't get used to the idea of working somewhere else, Trudy. It's almost as if I were committing infidelity.
I've got the want ads here.
Well, I'll look at them later.
You look at them now, because if you don't, I will. Hey, here's something for me. Cocktail waitress.
What do you say?
It sounds pretty good.
Well, even if you did go back to work, and I forbid it. Trudy, you were a school teacher.
I want a job that pays some decent money. I think I have nice legs.
A woman's place is at home with her kids.
Well, this would be at night when they're asleep. I can make enough money to pay the mortgage. And it's a restaurant, so maybe I could sneak home a little bit of food occasionally.
Are you serious?
At least we'll have a roof over our heads and something to eat now and then. Do you have another suggestion?
Give me that paper.
Let's see. You're James Madison Wilson, huh? Peter, you're not running for president. Now, this is your resume.
Yes, Mr.
All right. Sure does look impressive. Now, I've got a client who's looking for a man just like you. You've got exactly the right experience. Yes. This is going to be a marriage that was made in heaven. One little thing.
Yes, sir?
You didn't fill in number 15. Can't leave any blanks, you know. That can open up a whole can of worms.
What is number 15?
Right here. See where it says, reasons for leaving last job.
Oh. I was fired.
Oh, yes. Well, we don't have to put that up front. We'll just say that the job was terminated.
No, sir. I was terminated.
Yeah, well, write down that you were terminated because of a disagreement over company policy.
I can't write that down.
Why not?
Because I don't know what the company policy was.
Does it matter?
Oh, yes, sir.
To whom?
To me, sir. I'll just say I was fired.
I don't think we're communicating. You see, nobody's going to hold it against you that you were fired. But nobody's going to give you a job if you don't tell them why.
But, sir, I don't know why.
Didn't you ask?
Nobody knows.
Great. Now you can write down any reason you would not.
Oh, well, I can't tell a lie.
Hey, come on. Your name is James Madison, not George Washington.
Well, I don't want the job anyhow.
Then what did you come here for?
To satisfy my wife.
Well, you satisfy your wife on your own time, not mine.
Rudy?
Yes, it's me.
Trudy, where have you been? Do you realize it's 2:00 in the morning?
I know it's 2:00. The bar doesn't close till 1:30.
The bar? What bar?
My place of employment. The Sweet 16 Club.
Sweet 16?
Oh, what do you want from me? I'm just a waitress.
Well, my wife will not work as a waitress.
Oh, my feet are killing me.
My wife will not work, period.
I just got to get to bed.
Oh, no. We're going to talk about this, Trudy.
What's there to talk about? You want me to quit? You get a job.
Trudy, you come back here, Trudy.
Night.
Trudy, I will not stand for you working in a saloon.
Jim, please, let me fall asleep.
But you have a master's degree in education.
Yeah, and you should see the education I got tonight.
Trudy, get a quit, understand? I'll go out tomorrow. I'll find something. Trudy, pretty. What's the use? Let's see us.
Where's that waiter, Bart?
I'll just holler for one, Mr. Dennison.
What do you think of this place, Miss Anchors?
I want a drink.
There's the waiter. A waiter?
Oh, doesn't he have nice legs?
He looks familiar.
Waiter?
What? It's James Madison Wilson.
The one who got fired.
Is this a better job than the one he had with us, Mr. Dennison?
No, I don't know, Miss Anchors. But what did Wilson do when he worked for us?
I think he added up numbers.
Good evening.
What will you have?
Don't you know me? I'm Bart Scholes, your boss. I'm George Dennison, his boss. I'm Leslie Anchor, their boss. Oh, yes, I remember you. Now, what are you all doing in a place like this? We thought perhaps we could all become Sweet 16 again. Could I have some lemonade?
Could I have some soda pop?
Could I have some milk?
I'll think about it.
Look, the striptease act is about to begin.
I will not stay here and see womanhood degraded.
The stripper is a man.
Oh, that's another story. Bring me my lemonade.
My pop.
My milk.
No.
What do you mean, no?
I won't bring you anything until you tell me why I was fired.
Oh, no, Jim.
Ask us anything.
But don't ask that.
Why not? Why can't I ask?
Never ask.
But I have to know.
You don't want to know.
Why was I fired?
Why?
Jim.
Why?
Jim, darling, turn that thing off.
Why was I fired?
The alarm. I can't get up at 6 in the morning. I need my rest.
The alarm?
Will you please shut the thing off?
Oh, yes, yes, yes. There. It's off.
Oh, I have to go back to sleep. But as long as you're up, go downstairs.
Downstairs?
Make something hot for the kids before they go off to school. And make sure they have lunch money.
Trudy. Trudy, I had a nightmare.
Tell me about it later.
No, Trudy. I have to tell you now. I dreamed. Oh, it was so crazy. I can't remember what I dreamed.
Then you can't tell me about it, and I'm going back to sleep.
But I remember. I do remember I retained a thought from the nightmare.
Sure.
Trudy, please listen. Is it possible that they don't want to tell why I was fired for my own good?
I think Robert needs a note for his teacher.
Trudy, maybe I did do something wrong, and nobody wants to tell me because it could be too terrible.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing wrong with that is, if I did do something terrible, why wouldn't I know about it, Trudy? Huh? Now, what do you think, Trudy? It is possible. I could have done something very bad, because isn't each of us supposed to be two persons in reality? Trudy?
Oh. Why am I asking her?
Huh? Oh.
Bart. Bart, please. I have to talk to
you. Now, look, you have got your nerve.
I apologize, Bart. I had no right to get mad at you.
Look, James, I have an
apology. This'll only take a minute.
But I don't have a minute.
To me, it's life and death.
Look, I'm sorry. I have this meeting. Taxi!
Nobody wants to tell me why I was fired.
And I can't tell you either.
Please. Please, Bart, I have to talk to somebody.
I'm sorry, I have to run.
You're the only one, Bart. You have to talk to me. All right, not now. But just tell me when, Bart. Tell me when I can talk to
him. Just call me sometime. Driver, south on Park, and hurry.
Call you. I asked you, do you know what time it is?
Well, I've been trying all day.
It is 2:45 in the morning.
Yes, I know, and I'm sorry, but this is the first time your phone has answered.
James, tell me, what is the matter with you?
What, please? Please, you have to talk to me.
How can I talk to a maniac?
No, Bart. Bart?
Sir, do you mind if I turn it up a bit? I don't get a chance to use the steam room very often.
Whatever you want, Bart.
James! Oh, what are you doing here? This is a private club.
Bart, please. I'm suffocating and dying of the heat, but it was the only way to see you.
James, I am warning you.
What do I want, Bart? Just the answer to a question. That's a legitimate question, isn't it? I know I'm making a nuisance of myself, but please. I'll never bother you again. Just tell me, why was I fired?
I don't know.
Is that really true?
Yes, Jim.
Or is it that you don't want to tell me?
Jim, as your friend, I am telling you, I don't know.
Sure. You're my friend. Maybe that's why you don't want to tell me.
Please, believe
me. Sure, that's why. That's why you won't tell me. Now I understand. I was fired because I did something very wrong. Well, I did, didn't I? Didn't I?
Yes, you did. And that's all I can say to you.
And why do you wish to see me, Mr. Wilson?
Dr. Saunders, this is going to sound crazy. I want to meet the other person who occupies my body.
The other person?
Yes, doctor.
I see. And why do you want to meet him?
I want to throw him out.
Why?
Because he must be doing a lot of wrong things.
Such as?
Well, he got me fired from my job.
How?
Because of something that he did.
What?
Well, I don't know. It must have been something absolutely awful.
Why do you say that?
Well, I've been working for that firm 20 years without a single complaint. And all of a sudden, one day, I'm out.
Oh?
That's why, you see. Somehow, I have to expel this alien being from my body. You see, can that be done?
Yes.
Good.
Provided
what?
Provided that you are not the alien being in his body.
That idea never came up before, did it? Here all along, we've had our hero thinking that he was in control of his life, when it's completely possible that it's a life he cannot call his own. On the other hand, how many of us can do that? The time for all the answers is rapidly approaching. With Act 3. The poets and the philosophers, and of course the psychologists, tell us that each of us is not one, but many persons. So then, when we are at war with ourselves, it may mean that the different people who combine to form our personality are battling for supremacy. On the other hand, this may be complete nonsense. Listen.
I am the alien being in his body, Doctor? How can you say that? Well, this is my body.
How do you know?
Because I control it.
According to you, this other person does things you are unaware of. Doesn't that mean he controls it too?
I don't know. I don't know what to think.
When did this idea occur to you?
I'm not sure.
Before or after you lost your job?
After. Definitely after.
And so you came up with it to justify your being fired?
Well, what else? Makes sense, Dr. Saldus. I personally couldn't have done anything wrong, so the only way that I can explain it is, Jack the Ripper.
Really?
Oh, yes. Yes, he didn't know that he was committing a crime while he was killing those women. It was somebody else in his body, working unknown to him, wasn't that? So, wasn't it?
Does it matter?
Oh, yes, yes. It does, Doctor.
No, Mr. Wilson. It is all an aspect of the same psyche. Maybe there was a side of you that wanted to destroy the company.
Me? I would want to destroy the company? Doctor, I don't care how this sounds, but the fact is Well, I'm going to say it. I love that company.
Love and hate. Opposite sides of the same coin.
Oh, no, no. I could never.
Perhaps unconsciously you performed some great damage. And the company, unwilling to undergo the publicity that might result if they prosecuted, simply decided to dismiss you quietly.
Is that what happened?
I don't know, but from what you tell me, it's what you think happened.
Doctor, I may be a man who was born out of his time and place.
Yes?
You see, I loved my work. I loved the company I worked for. I've never been cynical about it the way so many people are.
You mean the company was perfect?
Oh, no, far from it, but this is what I was doing 8 hours every day. You see, this was one third of my life. So if it were meaningless, then one third of my life would be a lie. Doctor, I was so proud to be a part of it. What does a man have? His country, his job, his family. Then again, one third of his life is the place that he works for.
Then what happened?
Well, that's what I want you to tell me. You're the doctor.
That's what you must tell me. You are the patient.
But I don't know.
Perhaps you do not want to know.
Oh, but I do. Believe me.
Maybe you can't face the truth.
The truth? The truth is what I'm looking for, Doctor.
Are you sure you are not running away from it?
I don't know. I don't know what I'm doing anymore.
A man gives himself completely to a woman. He makes every sacrifice for her. And one day she abandons him. What happens to him?
I'm not sure I know.
You know, people who give themselves completely to anything or to anyone are destroyed by rejection.
Why did the company reject me?
Why does a woman suddenly reject a man who is faithful and loving? Who can say? But the rejected lover always looks for the fault in himself, never in the loved one.
Well, I must have done something wrong.
Why?
Because.
Because you cannot accept the fact that the loved one is imperfect. It must be your fault. And so you are willing to destroy yourself with this Jack the Ripper fantasy. No, Mr. Wilson. The company is to blame. Why did they fire you?
Well, no one wants to tell me.
Whom did you ask?
Oh, the various managers.
Small fry. Go to the top.
The top? You mean the chairman of the board?
I do.
Harold H. Hubble himself?
If that is his name.
Well, no one ever gets to see Mr. Hubble.
Why not?
Well, first, you have to be cleared by the security guards and the main receptionist, and then... Oh, no, listen, there's such a human wall around him, that just can't be done.
It must be done.
Well, he wouldn't know why I was fired.
Of course not, but he could push the right buttons and get the right answer.
Well, I could never get in to see him. Wait a minute. How did I get in to see Leslie Akers?
Yes. Oh, no, he wouldn't bother me at all. But please ask him to come in. Are you going to fix my telephone here, or are you going to take it away?
Neither. I'm not going to fix your phone at all.
Oh, well, aren't you the telephone repairman?
No, sir. No.
But you're wearing a belt with all those tools.
Well, I just bought them, sir. Most of them are made by Transcontinental.
Are they?
Please. Mr. Hubble, I had to see you. Don't call security and don't have me thrown out.
Why would I do a thing like that?
Well, it was the only way I could get in to see you.
Oh, I am so glad you're here. No one ever comes to see me. Have no idea how lonely it gets sometimes. Please sit down. May I offer you a cup of coffee?
Oh, thank you, sir.
Help yourself. It's cream and sugar. And now?
Sir, until a month ago, I worked for Transcontinental. Yes, sir. For 20 years.
Oh, 20 years. Yes. Why did you leave? I hope you weren't unhappy.
Oh, no, sir. I was fired.
Why?
Well, no one wants to tell me.
Where did you work?
I was with A14-270K.
What do you make over there?
Zarf's.
What is a Zarf?
This is a Zarf, sir. This holder in which this plastic coffee cup is held.
This is a Zarf?
Yes, sir. The word is originally Turkish.
Oh, fancy that.
Yes, they used to be made of metal. And in Turkey, they'd hold hot cups of tea. In America, they would hold soda glasses in the old days.
Oh, I think I've been using Zarf's all my life. And we actually make them.
Oh, yes, sir. Last year, we sold 17 million.
You really do learn something every day. What's your name?
Wilson, sir. James Madison Wilson.
And you were fired, and no one knows why?
Yes, sir. My immediate supervisor received this piece of paper.
Oh, yes, I see. Now, James, you realize that this is a computer printout.
Yes, sir.
And so, that's who fired you, is the computer.
What did the computer have against me?
Nothing. Can you keep a secret?
Oh, yes, sir. Yes.
Oh, yes, sir. The computer made a mistake.
Oh, is that all?
Well, that's what it had to be.
Well, can't you or anyone else in authority rehire me?
James, I like you. I really do. But you see, we can't do that.
But why not?
Because we cannot afford to admit that the computer made an error. Our entire operation could lose its credibility.
But it wasn't my fault.
No, of course not.
I'm still out of a job.
No, Arthur. I'll get you another one.
Where, sir?
Well, I can just pick up the phone and talk to my dear friend, Fred Fenris, at Worldwide.
Worldwide?
Yes.
Well, that's the competition, sir. They're the enemy. I've been fighting them for 20 years.
Yes, I know.
And you? Do you mean that you're friendly with the big boss up there?
We're even fraternity brothers.
Oh, no, I can't believe that.
Business is like any other war. The enlisted men kill each other, and the generals have a drink together afterwards.
Oh, no, I'm sorry, sir. I couldn't work for Worldwide. I'd feel like a traitor. And besides, they make a Zarf that's definitely inferior to ours.
My boy, I respect your integrity.
Well, I thank you, sir, and goodbye.
Must you go? I suppose so. Goodbye, James. Come to see me again soon. It's very lonesome up here. Promise?
Yes, sir. I promise. I notice you didn't ask me the usual question, Trudy.
What usual question?
Where did I look for a job today?
That's right. I didn't.
Why not?
Please, don't get angry, Jim. But you see, the fact is, you don't have to get a job.
Why don't I?
Because I just got a better one.
What?
They want me to manage the Sweet 16 Club. And not just that one, but their whole chain.
You?
Yes, Jim. For good money, too.
Well, who? We'll stay home and take care of the kids in the daytime.
You will, Jim. And why not? After all, as society changes, so do the traditional roles.
Well, I don't want to stay home. I want to go to work.
And I don't want to go to work. I want to stay home. What are we going to do, Jim? You just won't take a job with anyone else but Transcontinental.
Woody, can I help the way I feel? Well,
who could that be? Bart. And Mr. Dennison. And Miss Akers.
Jim and Trudy, please, hurry.
Hurry?
Yes, you have to come with us.
Where?
To a party.
Party?
A formal party.
Well, whose party?
Yours.
Mine?
Bart, does he have a tuxedo?
Yes, sir, he does.
All right, get dressed quickly.
Mrs. Wilson, let me go upstairs with you. The company bought you this gown.
Well, what is it?
Talk later, my boy. We're going to be late.
Well, why am I having a party?
Because Transcontinental wants to give you one.
That's right, Jim, for 20 years of faithful and valuable service.
Yes, in return for 20 years of faithful and valuable service, they fired me.
No, Jim, they didn't fire
you. What do you mean? I have the memo right here. James Madison Wilson is hereby terminated.
But James Madison Wilson was not supposed to be fired.
He wasn't?
No, my boy. The culprit was James Monroe Wilson.
The culprit?
Literally. He was caught stealing Zarf from our West Coast facility.
He got your letter and you got his.
You mean the computer made a mistake?
No, my boy.
Oh, no, never, never.
The computer cannot make a mistake. It was the human being who activated it.
Is that understood?
Is that clear?
And so you see, you were never fired.
And your party has been scheduled for tonight.
Yes, everyone will be there.
Do you mean that I was never fired?
Oh, of course not.
James Monroe Wilson was fired.
Well, we'll be late for the party.
All right, come on, the limousine is waiting.
And Mr. Hubble himself is going to present you with a gift.
Getting a gift? What could it be?
What? Yes.
What do you think?
I give up.
A solid gold Zarf.
He went, and he accepted it. And it was quite a party. The following morning, he returned to work in that vast office. Once again, he feeds numbers into that adding machine. And once again, he's a little cog, but secure in his big wheel. The only thing that distinguishes him from his mass of fellow workers is the solid gold Zarf that holds his cup at every coffee break. I shall return shortly. The solid gold Zarf. That's the prize, isn't it? Well, if it's not a Zarf, it's a solid gold watch or a solid gold plaque. That is, it used to be that way. With the price of gold what it is, one can't be sure anymore. That's usually the reward for 25 or 30 or even 50 years, a lifetime. We may laugh at the naivete and unworldliness of a James Madison Wilson, but when he finally retires, the solid gold Zarf will not have been his only reward. I can understand that because I love my work. I hope you love yours, too. That's really the solid gold Zarf. Our cast included Larry Haynes, Francis Sternhagen, Earl Hammond, and Robert Dryden. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown.
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Raven House Paperback Mysteries.
This is E.G. Marshall, inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.